Well, all right. We are He's Alive Church. Our mission is bringing life to dead places. And it's good to see every one of you all here today. If this is one of your first times with us, we want to tell you three things. Everybody else knows what I'm going to say. Say it with me. We love you. We appreciate you. And we thank you. If you're looking for a church home, we want to be able to help you in God leading you to the place where He wants you to land. The best way that we know how to do that is by asking you to stop by our welcome center in the lobby area before you leave. You have a personal interaction with somebody at that desk. We're going to give you a gift packet from us to you. In that packet are things that will tell you all about He's Alive Church, who we are, what we're about, our mission, our principles, and all of that stuff. If you don't want that personal interaction, you can scan the QR code on one of the backs of the chairs in front of you, text He's Alive to 77411, or go to our website at he'salivechurch.org. Follow the prompts for I'm New Here, and they will take you through a series of things that will give you all of that same information. But one way or another, really want to encourage you to take an opportunity to do that, and we will be in prayer with you about that process. We're starting our worship service today, which, by the way, if you are new here today, don't anybody be alarmed by that ladder over there. We use a ladder in all of our worship services here at He's Alive Church. But today, we especially have a purpose. That ladder is actually there, not by random chance. It's there for a purpose. So some of y'all, I know you got OCD, and you're like, who left that ladder out? Well, it was put there for a reason. So you'll see later on. All right, now, we're starting with ministry opportunities. Is Sabrina here? Where's Sabrina? Okay, well, she was not here for her opportunity. So, Bill, you're up here for your opportunity. Tell them about how they can get plugged in some ministry.
All right. Sabrina, one more chance. Okay, she needs help with egg and candy collection, and that's all I know about it. All right, so I'm pretty sure it has something to do with Easter, but...
No, that's it. They need help. They're collecting candy and eggs and candy. Plastic eggs, not real eggs. Bring the real eggs to me. Bring the plastic eggs to Sabrina. Oh, there she is. All right now. All right.
No entrance.
Better late than never. Sabrina, what you got? We are talking about you collecting eggs, candy, plastic eggs. Bring the real eggs to me. But since you ran in here, go ahead.
Sorry, I'm always after the music. Okay, Easter egg hunt is here this year, so it's going to be a huge outreach for the community. We hope that we have an Easter bunny coming. It's going to be tons of fun. So we're going to put a giant bin out there, and the goal is to fill that bin with eggs and candy every single week. So we're going to collect from now until March 17th, 18th. So bring your candy, bring your eggs. We need tons because it's going to be here, and hopefully lots of people are going to show up. So you can pray for it, pray for the families that are going to be here, and soon you'll be able to volunteer to be here.
All right. So, real eggs to Mark, deviled eggs.
Wait a minute.
Sky.
No, you can bring me the deviled eggs, too.
No. You made your call. All right. So, today is the deadline for mission trips. We have 3 mission trips this summer. In June, we're going to Nicaragua. And in July, we are going to Moldova. And at the end of July, going to Alaska. If you need any more information on any of those trips, they're all 3 very unique and different trips. We do have the flyers out in the lobby, but you can also talk with me. Josh is over the Nicaragua trip, and Glenn is over the Alaska trip. If you have any questions, let us know. But you need to sign up by today because we're already organizing the teams, prepping, getting ready, and we got to get on it. So today is the deadline. If you have any questions, let me know. Also, as you know, majority of what we do mission-wise is right here in our own community. And we are on Tuesday, February 20th. We're going to be at Lifeline Christian Mission. What we do there is we actually pack meals. These meals go in bags that go all over the world. They're packed with protein, and basically one bag can feed a family of six a meal. And we pack thousands of meals in an hour, all right? So that is at 6 o'clock on Tuesday night, the February 20th, and we ask you to go ahead and sign up. I believe I reserved for us 20 spots this time, and so I encourage you to do that. It's not only a great outreach, but it's also a lot of fun, great team building. Encourage you to be about it. That is our church-wide monthly outreach for the month of February. Also want to remind you that in the fall, in October, sounds like a long way away, we know it's not, we are hosting a Walk in the Footsteps of Paul tour. This is in Greece, and it is where we actually go to the places that you read about in the Bible. Many of the books, many of the letters that Paul wrote, the epistles, to those places we're going to go to. Ephesus, Thessalonica, Philippi, all of these places that you see in the Bible, we're going to actually go and walk in those footsteps and see where all this took place, where these early churches were planted. So check it out. These are out in the lobby. Check it. Let us know if you got any questions about all of that. And thank you. Thank you for praying for me and William Wilson as we went to Liberia. Got back last Sunday night. A lot of traveling. Too long of traveling. But the ministry was phenomenal. And we had a great time training pastors from like 8:30 to 4 every day, sweating through our clothes. You could wring out those clothes, all right, from the heat. Many obstacles. But, you know, many times when there are obstacles, it's because God's up to something, and the enemy don't like it, all right? And so all those obstacles God overcame, and the investment in pastors who then went back to their churches, hopefully better equipped, with information and equipping that they can't get anywhere else. It's all about spreading and building up the kingdom of God around the world. So thank you for being a part of that. You give this church, you are part of that. Even though, and you thank me for having to endure all them flights on your behalf, but you went with me, all right? So thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness.
Now, speaking of thankfulness, I also want to thank all of you who serve each and every week here at He's Alive Church. We want to be intentional to say thank you, but we also, one of the things we do once, and they had a praise pit over there. Yeah, I'm going to tell you right now, you'll never see Billy Wilson doing that in church, but we're going to bring him to He's Alive Church, and he's going to do it here. But since he's not here, all right, that's good. Y'all can sound. But Bill is here. Bill, we know, you say, put your yes on the table. You're the one who coined the phrase. So you can't go across the ocean and lead a praise pit and not do it here at your own home church, my friend. So today, I'm calling praise pit. I'm calling praise pit at the beginning just for one song. If you're new here, don't be alarmed. It's okay. We use a ladder every week in our services, and sometimes we use praise pits, but it's okay. It's going to end up good in the end. But Bill is going to come down to the front. Come on down, Bill. And Bill, in this first song, I chose this song for this moment. Now listen, some of you young people over here, I don't know where Jay Remy is with the, he was supposed to bring them kids in here. But listen, anybody that wants to join Bill, don't leave Bill alone. Everybody look at your neighbor and go, don't leave Bill alone. Come on, Jeremy. Somebody join Bill in the praise pit, and we're going to praise God this morning for all the things he's done for us. So let's get up and let's praise today. Come on. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Come on now. Anybody else coming up with Bill? Come on. We need some people on this side. All right, there you go. Yeah. Then we get to the chorus. When we get to the chorus, y'all can all give your best. Pray. All right? We ready? All right, come on, everybody. Lift your voice. Here we go. I praise in the valley. Yeah. I praise on the mountain. Yeah. I praise when I'm sure and praise when I'm down in. That's right. I praise when I'm numbered and praise when surrounded. Yes, I will. Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. Hallelujah. Yeah. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Yeah. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Come on, D, take it here. Everybody.
I praise when I feel it, and I praise when I don't.
Oh, yeah, both times.
I praise because I know you're still in. My praise is a weapon. It's more than a sound.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
My praise is the shout that brings Jericho
down. All of the walls come down today. Yeah.
So as long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul.
Testify today. Anybody want to testify today? Come on. Let's say this. I praise cause you're sovereign. Praise cause you reign. I praise cause you rose and defeated the rain. I praise cause you're faithful. Praise cause you're true. Praise cause there's nobody greater. Now you take it. Come on.
Praise cause you're sovereign.
Seated. Whew. Oh, yes. Isn't that good? Bill says, don't ever do that to me again. I may or may not be here next week. I want to share a scripture today in thankfulness. But before I do, there's a line in there that says, I praise when I feel it, praise when I don't. Sometimes we walk up on the mountains, but if you ever notice, mountaintops are great. They give us a good perspective. We need to go up on the mountain occasionally. But most of the living, the breathing, and the dying is done in the valley. The valley is where the beauty is, because that's what makes the mountaintop view what it is. So today, we want to really just pray for everybody who might be walking through a valley. If that's you today, you're in a valley, you're in a difficult time, you're on a road marked with suffering. We want to lift all those concerns up to the Lord today. Today we're praying for, I want to just pray for the Reinhardt family. Brian's father, Jim, this note says went to heaven. So Father, we pray for the Reinhardts, and we pray for them as they grieve and as they walk through, not get hung up in the valley of the shadow of death. You are the one who takes us through it, and we thank you that you do. We pray for all those who are in the midst of grief and difficult times today. We pray that you move as you will, that you have your way, that you would remind us that in these things, that from your perspective, you call light and momentary, but the rough when we're in them, God, remind us that you are using these things to prepare us for a glory that far outweighs them all. And as your word says, we know that these difficulties bring us opportunities for joy. They bring opportunity for endurance, strength, and hope that will not fail. I want to pray today. Ed, are you in here? Ed McAfee, where are you at? Stand up, Ed. Come on up here. I want to pray for Ed and Patra. Many of you know, if you know Ed's story, his wife is battling terminal cancer. So the time is drawing near. And I just want to pray for him and his family. So anybody who wants to come up and lay hands on Ed right now, he's going to stand in for Patra and their family, and just want to pray for them. God, we pray for Ed today. We know that you are the God who heals, and we know that you are able to heal her on this side of heaven if you see fit. You can work beyond what doctors say and what medicine, where medicine stops and fails, you can keep it on going. And if that's your will, we pray that you do it. But Father, if your greatest healing is the one that sometimes is also the most painful, but yet is the greatest, if the greatest is the resurrection and a new body in eternity, then we pray that you give them the strength, the awareness, the comfort to walk through this road marked with suffering in the coming months. You will remind them of your faithfulness, your greatness, and who you are, and let us surround them in every step. We pray and we ask it in the name of Jesus, and everyone said together, amen. To share this verse from Philippians chapter 4. The Apostle Paul says this: I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or empty, or with plenty or in want. For I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Today we will do something that we annually do about this time every year, and I'll tell you what that is in just a little bit, but I want to say this to preface that and preface what we're doing now, which is each and every week we take time to give thanks back to God. We ask our ushers to come forward, and we give back to Him in song, in prayer, in testimony, and in a material way. We pass a plate. Understand that most people who give, if you give, you give digitally. But the plate is a reminder to us of God's faithfulness, and it's a reminder to us that He is first. I want to say this. Last year, 2023, we celebrated 10 years of God's faithfulness. Kind of going along with what Paul said. The first 6 years of our existence, we learned the joy of knowing what it was like to operate in the fullness of abundance, to operate with plenty, to have the joy of praying through, God, what will we do with the abundance that you give us over and above what we need to make a difference for your kingdom? That was a fruitful 6 years. In the last 4 years, when COVID hit, we have had the joy and the opportunity of learning how to live in plenty and in want. And we've had the joy of praying through, okay, God, how are we going to make it from this month to the next by just staying afloat, staying in this building, paying our bills, and then still in the midst of that, trying to find a way to do ministry and the mission that you've called us to. And in the first six and the last four, I want to testify that God is faithful. He is good. He is good on the road marked with abundance, and He is just as good on the road marked with suffering and labor. Blessed be the name of the Lord our God. I want to thank those of you who give faithfully each and every week, and I want to thank our leadership team, our finance team, our staff, and every person who has worked in the years of less being more to bring us to a place where we're still here, the lights are on, praying for each other, and the mission is going forth. So, Father, we thank you today, first and foremost, for your faithfulness. But I want to thank you for the leadership that you put in this church, people who make tough decisions, and people who steward and manage your money, the resources that you give to us well, with authenticity and integrity and with wisdom. There's no price for that one. Thank you. So today, as we do every week, we give back to you and ask you to be blessed in it and work and use it as you see fit. And it's the mighty name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Let's sing and let's give thanks together today.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Hey. every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. We're gonna say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Throw this pain in me, offering. Blessed be your name.
The road.
Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name.
Say it again.
Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain.
You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Though you give and take away. You give and you take away. But my heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Though you give and you take away, you give and you take away, but my heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed, even when it's hard, Lord,
said of us, Lord. Let it be said of us.
Though you came, my heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Father, in every circumstance and in every situation, you are faithful, you are good. On every road, in the abundance, in the lacking, and the suffering, may our heart choose to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Come and speak to us by your word today, Lord. Open our hearts and our minds. I pray that you remove every distraction, anything that would hinder us from hearing what we need to hear today. Still our hearts, calm us down, Lord. And may your word rest deep in us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Today, I mentioned that we're doing something that we do this time every year. In an effort to function with full transparency, authenticity, and as much integrity as we can with Jesus as our righteousness, we always bring what we call an annual report. This annual report is a report about how last year went for us in faithfulness. That includes our service, our outreach, and our finances. When we're done with this today, on your way out, you can pick up one of these. It's in print form. You can take it with you, and you can read it. What you'll find yourself reading is everything that we're about to share with you in message form. Now, you see paper and you hear numbers, and immediately the mind can check out. Don't check out today, because we're not reporting it that way. I also know that some people, as all church folk will do, might be thinking right now, well, all right, here we go. Another church talking about money. That's all they do is talk about money. Even though we've been preaching through Colossians for almost a year now, but that's all they do is talk about money. I don't know why we're talking about money. But the truth is, Jesus said as much or more about money in the New Testament than he did anything else. So if we're a church who follows Jesus, it stands to reason that at some point we have to talk about what he talked about, even if we don't like it. And the reality is just we know human nature. Here's the thing. People don't mind talking about money. They just don't like talking about money in church. People have no problem talking about money with Carnival Cruise Line. Carnival, I hate to burst your bubble, but Carnival does not exist just to take you on wonderful vacations. They exist to talk to you about your money. And if you go on a cruise with them, at the end of the day, they want to have a conversation with you about your money. Disney World is the same thing. It will shock you, but they might have started this way, but they do not exist to create wonderful family memories for you. At the end of your checkout experience, Disney will want to have a conversation with you about your money. If you leave here today and you go out to eat, the waiter, the chef, and the establishment that you go to before you leave are going to want to have a conversation with you about your money. If you leave here today and you go to Food Lion, Food Lion is going to want to have a conversation with you about your money before you leave. But nobody ever says, I'm going to tell you right now, every time I go in Food Lion, that's all they want to do is talk about my money. I'm going to tell you right now, when I cruise, that's all they want to do is talk about my money. And last night in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, where tickets were going at a minimum of around $400 for the cheap seats, and probably more than that, I'm going to tell you right now, nobody had a problem having a conversation with the University of North Carolina about money, except the Duke fans when they left. The reason, if we're honest, we don't like to talk about money in the church is because that's the place where our money starts talking about us. So today, we're going to share with you good news. Good news from our faithfulness report. I'm just going to go through it, this part of it. In the year 2023, we have this to be thankful for. We average 260 people in person worship. That's up huge from the years since COVID. There were 94 online for 354 total. We praise the Lord for that. We also want to give thanks that out of all those people, 181 of you were actively serving during worship services, not all at one time, but across the board. 171 active in life groups, Bible studies, or Sunday school. 21 baptisms, hallelujah. 20 of you, what's next class, joined in covenant membership in He's Alive Church. We were able to reach approximately 2,500 at Trunk or Treat and 1,266 at Christmas in the City, a handful of which at that event gave their lives to Jesus Christ, and many more who recommitted their lives to Jesus Christ. We praise the Lord for that. And then when it comes to money, I'll do this last one and then hand it off to Bill. Total tithes and offerings that we brought in were $878,225. Total expenses were $851,375. And I want to say again, the expense part is a testament to our leadership, our finance teams, our staff, as they work together to fulfill God's mission in what has been a very difficult season for us. All right, Bill, you want to tell them the rest? And again, all of this, you'll be able to take with you on a paper as you leave on that table in the back today. This is Illusions with Bill. No, this is no illusion. It's a hard fact.
Okay, so first of all, for 2023, we brought in $878,000, and we spent $851,000, and we are grateful for that. There were some sizable, substantial, one-time gifts that were given that we're so grateful for. God gets the glory for all of it. Doesn't matter when it comes in, how it comes in, but the faithfulness of the people to give and to be generous in recognizing that everything that we have anyway belongs to the Lord. When we look at our finances and we look at them and we say, all right, what do I need to give to the church? Well, we start off on the wrong foot. You're not even in the right ballpark. It's gratitude where it begins of everything that God has given to me. But wait a second, I worked for it. Oh, okay. Who gave you them legs, that head, them arms? Who put you in that position? It all belongs to the Lord. The Bible is extremely clear that everything in all creation belongs to Him, including your bank account. And so that's our starting place, and then it becomes, what do I keep from what God has given me to supply for my family and my needs? And we go with that gratitude. So we're grateful. We're grateful for all who gave to that. And then when we look at that breakdown, we break it into kind of following along with the principles, our seven principles here, with worship, prayer, scripture, creative arts. That breakdown of that 851,000, 123,000 went into that. Outreach, 140,000, 585. Scripture and shared experience, 195,000. Operations, 391,000. Now what we do with that is we, in those figures, we are splitting up the responsibilities of staff members as well. Because sometimes when churches look at it, they just go, okay, here's your fixed expenses, here's your personnel, and here's your ministry. But really, personnel is all about ministry as well. And so the different areas that our different staff members intersect with and oversee, we spread that out. So when you're looking at those numbers, that's how we break that out and break that down as well. Now, when we're looking at the 2024 budget, you'll see we're at 860,000. Now, I want to tell you that in 2020, in 2019, Mark mentioned first 6 years of our existence, we were praying hard about how to use the surplus. Okay, we were finishing each year with so much extra that we were like, okay, how do we invest this for kingdom purposes? Going into 2020, we adopted our largest budget in the history of the church, not knowing there was a pandemic coming, okay? And so from then on through the years, we've tried to be very responsible. Our finance team working in tandem with our lead team, being played out by our staff, working to be wise stewards of the resources that God has given us. So that budget has gradually come down while at the same time, expenses in life have gone up, right? You know this in your own life. Your expenses are going up. Guess what? The expenses, the operating expenses here go up as well. And so very proud of our staff, our ministry leaders who have worked within confines to make ministry happen. And for the past 3 years, or this will be the third year, that we are actually, for ministries, we are working on a cash-based system. And what that means is, on a budget system, they have a number on a page, and you just got to stay under that number for the year. We are actually in a system where now, where you have money in your fund that we fund every time that we have an excess, every time that we have a surplus, we put money into the ministry funds. And then that money in that ministry fund is what you have to work with, okay? So the beauty of it is when we have months that we bring in more than we spend, we are able to funnel that right into ministry, okay? We are not a bank, all right? We're not looking to store up money, tons of money for rainy season. Everything we get extra goes into ministry, okay? So this green here, that represents the total amount of money that comes in. That represents, if you're looking at that budget figure, that would be the $860,000. That's the green right there. Now, somebody did ask me, Cheryl asked me if this was going to be a magic trick. And I wish it was. If it was, I would make that double right there. I just make it double because it'd be all in the ministry, right? But it's not a magic trick, all right? So what we have here is how does this break down? And so right here, this is operating. What do we mean by operating? Operating means what it takes to keep the doors open. Okay? We have a lease. We rent. Okay? We have to pay the power bill. Okay? We have to get office supplies. We have communications. We have different things that it takes to operate. We also include in that personnel. These, in essence, are I'm going to do this more accurate than I do with my spices and cooking. Close. So out of that, that's our operate. Okay? That's a lot, right? But that's what it takes for us to be here and to do what we do for the kingdom. All right? Then we have missions. So what you need to know about missions is that every time that you give, 10% of that goes into our mission fund off the top. In other words, we don't give into missions like some people give personally. Some people give personally. They pay everything, and then they figure out what's left, figure out what they can part with, and be generous to put that in the pot. We don't do that. What we do is we say off the top, non-negotiable, 10% of everything that goes in, 10% of everything that comes in is going into missions. We're just putting it in there. And it goes, okay? Hello. So, there's you about 10%. And actually, it's 11% because we take 1% and we put that into a benevolence fund. Now, I want to be clear. With benevolence, benevolence is to help people who are in crisis within our own body, within the body of believers. Even in Acts 2, when you see the church beginning, they shared what they had. They took care of so that it actually says so no one actually had a need. Okay? So for the body of Christ, we have a benevolence fund. When people, and we use it, when people encounter difficult times, unexpected times. You might say, well, why don't we use that for people outside the church? Well, I'll tell you why. It's not because we don't care. But it's very difficult. In fact, it's impossible for us to vet every person that comes and knocks on the door. And once you give to one, the stream comes. Y'all don't have to deal with it. All right? Everybody's got a story. Do you think all those stories are legit? Most of them are actually not. We don't have the resources. We don't have the time. We're not able to vet who's legit and who's not. So you know what we do? Out of the mission fund, we give every month to Rowan Helping Ministries. We give every month to Cooperative Christian Ministries. We give to organizations right here in our own community that is their mission. That's what they are built for. They vet people, and they find the needs, and they help people. They help people find housing. They help people find food. They help people find jobs. They stand in the gap. That is why they exist. And so we support them heavily. Honestly, almost a quarter of what we give monthly out of the mission fund goes into those two organizations because they really are on the front lines. And if someone comes and they go, oh, I've talked to them, they won't help me, there's probably a reason for that. Not being cruel. But if these organizations exist to help and they're turning you down, there's probably a reason for that. So we, when people come, we have a whole list of community resources and Christian resources to help people who are in need. And we funnel them to that, and we talk to them, and we pray with them. But financially, we're not paying people's power bills. We're not paying, you know, people come and they're like, my power's getting cut off today. Well, I'm sure this isn't the first you've heard about it. Okay, we're not being mean. We're trying to be wise stewards. So we funnel the missions into those. And then with people who are part of the body, we have a benevolence fund. Because you know what? You're accountable, right? We see you each week. We know the need. We know you. We can vet you. And so we have the benevolence fund to help out with that. Now, the final category would be ministries, okay? Now we look at that and we go, whoa, that is not a lot. True story. It's not a lot financially. But we also understand that ministry is a lot more than finances, right? Ministry is relationships, and ministry is guiding people and investing in people and spending time with people. And, you know, we found that time is actually, in this day and age, a greater commodity than dollars. And so, this is ministry. So what happens is, when we start off the year, praise the Lord, because of the way we ended the year, we were able to make sure that all of our ministries, we have 11 now that have their designated funds, and every one of those was able to start the year with money in there. Okay? Yeah, praise the Lord. Hey, don't take that for granted. Because again, we're having to fund it on a cash basis. So that means they know whatever is in there, they've got, and they can use for ministry. However, just to make sure that your visual is as accurate as can be, this you got personnel who's overseeing ministry, who's engaged in ministry. The Bible actually says in Ephesians that the pastors and the teachers and the leaders, they are to equip believers for ministry. They're not to do all the ministry. You know, who's the ministers in here? I won't take time to go through it, but it's you. It's all of us. I have a specific role. Mark has a specific role. But every believer, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you're a minister in the church of Christ. Okay? You've been called to ministry. The staff is called to lead ministers throughout the body. And as we invest in, we disciple, we make disciples, and so we are fully engaged in all of that. By the way, if everybody gives generously and faithfully, what does God do? He starts adding to this, right? Because that's 11% off the top. And so when this grows. Operating, there's not much we can do about that. You can't negotiate a power bill, right? And so the things that it takes to stay open, to stay here, those are things we can't control. The things we can, we're trying to be wise stewards of. But basically, that's how it breaks down. And so each month, we trust the Lord to work through his people, to provide the financial resources to do what God has called us to do. And whatever we get, we're going to use it for the mission. The mission is not going to change. The principles of the church are not going to change. Our direction, not going to change. We may have to get real creative at times. We've had to do that. That's okay. But we're not changing. And we're going to keep pressing on to what God has for us with whatever he chooses to give us. And so thank you. If you've been a part of that, if you've been a part of this right here, thank you. Thank you for your faithfulness. But you don't need that from me. You are being blessed by the Lord. Because he blesses his people who understand his ownership and who are faithful in generosity. Thank you. If you haven't been a part of this, I'm not dogging you. I just ask you to pray about it. Because you want to be a part of this. You want to go with me when I go to Liberia. You want to go with our team in Nicaragua, even if you never get on an airplane. In March, I go to Nepal to train pastors. You're not going with me, but you are going with me if you're in this. If you give, let's be about it together. It's the kingdom of God. At the end of the day, our bank accounts won't last. Our houses won't last. Our resources and material things won't last. But everything we do to build up the kingdom of God will be eternal and will last forever.
So let's wrap this up this way. So here I have awesome news and challenging news to share with you today. Here's the awesome news. The awesome news is that I probably shouldn't announce this, but it's true. We already have everything that we need to meet this for 2024. The challenging news is it's all in your pockets. And mine. So God has a plan. Maybe you've never heard of this, but he has actually a biblical plan for how he uses that. And he actually uses the resources that he entrusts us with in the process of sanctification. And so when he tells us to manage the resources this way, he says, this is what I'm going to do to grow you up into maturity in me, to make you more like me, to make you more generous and more sacrificial, and to make you actually more joyful, but ultimately to prepare you for your true home, which is not here, but in eternity. And there's all sorts of ways, but there's just three fundamental ways I want to close with today that he does this. You may have never heard this, but biblically, this is actually three fundamentals that he uses, that he'll ask us to do as his managers. One, he'll ask us to be consistent and intentional givers. That means make a plan. 1 Corinthians 16:2 says, on the first day of each week, you should each put aside a portion of the money you have earned. So both the New and the Old Testament affirm a plan, like a plan, a plan. It's not like Bill was talking about, like you come to the end of everything and you go, I got a mint, I'll throw that in there, and I got two pennies and I'll throw that in there. That's not the biblical plan. God's plan is make a plan. Set aside an amount. And the amount that you set aside, actually, let that be your first fruits, not your last, not your leftover. Let it be the best of what you have to offer. So make a plan. The second thing, biblically, that he'll ask us to do as managers of his resources is he'll want us to be proportional givers. What do we mean by that? Well, notice in that previous verse, it says, on the first day of each week, you should each set aside a portion of the money that you have earned. Now, in the Old Testament, in Malachi chapter 3, God with his covenant people said, I'll tell you what, I'm going to give you this plan. Here's what you do. You bring all the tithes into the storehouse so there will be enough food in my temple. So God set up, his people were just like us. I'm like, okay, God, you want me to bring everything, but what is everything? How do I know? How do I trust my heart? You say in your word, the heart is deceitful above all things. How do I know if my heart is right? I don't know. I'll tell you what, here's the plan. You bring me 10%. 10%. You keep, and trust me for the other 90 to provide, and you manage and live your life on that, and you bring me 10%. And that was the tithe. That was the system he set up with his people. Now Jesus in the New Testament in Luke 11, he said, you should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things. So Jesus says, that's a good plan. You should actually consider that. You should actually do that. But as you do, don't forget what's most important. And the most important thing in the plan is our heart. Because at the end of the day, that's what giving is about. Listen, money issues are never first management and budget issues. They're always heart and surrender issues. And that's really what God is after. Look, you could give 30% of your income and your heart not be in it and God not want a piece of it. What he's really after is the heart, which leads us to the third part of the plan. So we got consistent and intentional, make a plan. We've got set aside a portion, which is to be your best. And then the third biblically fundamental thing that God will do is he'll ask us to be sacrificial and cheerful givers. 2 Samuel 24, David said, I will not sacrifice to the Lord that which costs me nothing. And that's, by the way, why God said of David, that dude right there, he's a man after my own heart. Because God is ultimately after the heart. He's not after your money. He's after your heart. And so some of you may be hearing this plan and you may go, that's hard. That's hard. It's supposed to be. The faith walk is hard. That's why Jesus said, if anyone will come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. It's supposed to be hard. That's how God prepares us for eternity. It's going to cost. But it all comes down to one word, value. 2 Corinthians 9:7, Paul said, God loves a person who is a cheerful giver. Your giving should be sacrificial, but also be cheerful. But it's the sacrifice that will lead you to the joy. So make a plan. Be intentional. Set aside up front the first amount. And whatever that is for you, just start somewhere today, but make sure it's the best. God instituted a great plan. My family, we follow that plan, 10%. But whatever the plan, make sure it's your heart. And as you give it both sacrificially and cheerfully. And Jesus, he put it another way in Matthew chapter 6. In Matthew chapter 6, he said, look, verses 19 through 21. He says, look, don't store up treasures here on earth where moths eat and rust destroys them and where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasures in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, here it is, there the desires of your heart will be also. God's using our treasures to get to earth. What the real matter is, that's the heart. So basically what Jesus is saying here is, live with an eternal mindset. Don't live for here. Jesus is saying, live for me. Live with eternity as your priority. All of this is not the destination. Everything you're living for is not the destination. The true destination is eternity. So live like that's the true destination. Everything else is just preparation for the true destination. So live with your eyes on the true destination. Don't live for here. This is not your home. But the problem is most of us live like this is the destination. I got to get it now. I got to enjoy it now. We always play that game. If you're about to die, what would your last meal here on earth be? Well, any Christian should say, I don't care if my last meal is rice and kidney beans because that's just going to be the last of my average meals. In a second, I'm about to start getting the good meals for eternity. And Jesus says, live like that. Live like that. But here's the problem. We'll trade that in and we live like this is the destination. And we don't do it on purpose. Nobody's going to say, I'm living for here, I'm living for the world, because that's all there is. No, an atheist will. But most church folk are not going to do that. It happens very deceptively. And the problem, though, is when you live as though this is the destination, you will seek to avoid and to resist all the things God puts into your life as actual preparation for the true destination. And the one thing, the one and only thing that planet Earth can produce that will help you do that is your money. Because money will keep you from saying no to you. And before long, we don't even know it. But we think we're on top of it, but we're living for here, and we're up underneath our money, and we're a slave to our money, and we're in debt, and we're chasing this thing and that thing, and I got to get it all in before I die. No, you don't. This is not the destination. And that's why Jesus goes on in that chapter to say, look, verse 24, you can't serve two masters. You're going to hate the one and love the other. You'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. It's popular today. I've got all kinds of friends on Facebook who'll post, I'm going to tell you right now, you better look out for this preacher and that preacher. And they're all the time posting all the presumably false preachers and false teachers. And listen, there's plenty of them out there. As a matter of fact, just one chapter over in Matthew 7:15, Jesus himself said, beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inside are ravenous wolves. But long before he got to that one, he warned first of the most deadliest of all false teachers. And that's the one you live with, you sleep with, you go on vacation with, you pay your bills with, you walk with, you talk with. It has incredible potential for good or has incredible potential for deceptive destruction. And the biggest false teacher that you will have to worry about in your life is not the one over there, not the one they post about at Facebook, not the one down here at the conference, but the one you walk with every day, and that's your money. Your money will be the biggest false teacher you better look out for. Because it will fool you and deceive you. And before long, here's the thing. You will live your whole life trying to climb this ladder right here. Here's the ladder, okay? You're going to be up on this ladder trying to... Jimmy, if I fall now, you catch me. But anyway, you'll be up on this ladder. And you're climbing the ladder to success. The ladder to pleasure. Fame. Vacation, whatever, everybody's on this ladder, only to realize when life gives you a gut punch and everything falls apart, you've been climbing this ladder only to realize this ladder is leaning against the wrong wall. This is where our money deceives us. And this is why Jesus closed that whole teaching with this verse right here. Seek the kingdom of God first, above all else. Live righteously. And then everything else you need, everything else, everything that's on this wall will be added unto you. So I'll take care of all that. You just seek me first. So here's how that breaks down. In the church, there are three types of managers of money. This is a verifiably, statistically true fact. And as much as I hate to admit it, I would love to go, but we're different. We're not. We follow the same statistic here at He's Alive Church. Here's how it goes. You have three different kinds of managers of money. You have those who, now I'm talking about church folk. Two-thirds of the people in church don't give a dime. They give zero. So when Jesus says, seek ye first the kingdom of God in all his righteousness, and then I'll add everything else, they hear that and they go, nah. Thank you, but no thank you. Which is, I mean, you're thinking about that and you go, but I'm telling you, two-thirds. Then there's the other third. And of the other third, here's the second group of managers. Of the other third, 97% of that third, they give. But they give infrequently and they give minuscule amounts. And the reason they do that is because, as Bill said, what they do is get on this ladder. And they go, I'm going to get all this first. And then once I get this, if there's any left over, then I'll throw it over on that wall that Jesus is talking about. So as long as I get mine, then I'll throw my loose change to God. And Jesus says in Matthew 6:33, don't be either one of those. But I'm going to say it one more time. Two-thirds of church folk and 90%, 97% of the other third are those folk that Jesus says, don't be those folk? So that leaves us with the 3% of the third. And the 3% of the third say, I'm going to do it the Jesus way, and I'm going to seek God first, and we're going to give Him the first fruits. We're going to put Him first and trust Him to provide and give us the other 90% or whatever else is left. We'll worry about all that stuff, but we're going to give first to God. And these are the faithful, consistent, who follow the plan. These are the 3% who get on this ladder and say, I'm putting my ladder on this wall. All right? So just to give you the visual for that, and our church is no different. That's about how many that is for us. This many is taking care of all that. That's how it happens in the church. And it's almost laughable. Like, you see that and you go, you're joking, right? No, I'm not. So who is being deceived? What false teacher are you listening to? I'll close with this story. There's a story about a guy in the Bible. His name is Job. He actually has a book written about him. And that book is all about the Christian response to suffering, or how we should handle suffering. It's a great book. You should read it. But in the first chapter of that book, I'm going to paraphrase here, but here's how it goes down. Everybody look at me. Listen real close. Pay no attention to those people moving about the room. Look at me. God is there and Satan comes in. And God's like, Satan, what you been doing? Satan's like, I've been going around all the earth. I've been roaming to and fro, doing my thing, causing destruction. And God says, well, have you considered Job? Do you see Job? Job's a righteous man. Job's got his ladder on this wall. As a matter of fact, that chapter, Job 1, tells us he is the most righteous in all the land. Have you considered Job? What about Job? You see Job? Mm-hmm. And Satan says, well, I'm going to tell you what, God. The only reason Job is righteous is because you give him everything that's on this wall. You bless him. But you take all of that, and I'm going to tell you right now, Job will take his ladder off that wall in a second and put it on this one, and he will curse you to your face. Strip him. Put him on the road marked with suffering, God. We'll see what he does. And God says, okay, you can have him. You can take all his stuff, but you can't touch him. Now, that Job chapter 1 tells us that Job's the richest man in all the land. So he has everything this wall can offer. And when God says, Satan, you can have him, Satan has his way. And in a matter of, seconds and minutes, Satan torments him with everything. And Job, Satan throws everything he has at him. And Job loses everything. Everything. All his riches, all his wealth. He had 10 children, all of them dead. The only thing he has left is his wife and a few friends, most of which who give him some bad advice. He is completely undone. Now, this part's not in the chapter, but I'm just paraphrasing here. Imagine the scene. So Satan says, Job's down. He's out for the count. Come on, all my demons. Y'all come with us, and we're going to go listen to the countdown because Job's about to curse his God. And he gathers them all up, and they come. And they're just waiting and waiting. And when he shows up, what does he find? He does not find a man with clenched fists. He does not find a man who in bitterness or anger. He does not find a man who is saying, God, I served you. I did all this for you, and you do this for me. What does he find? He finds a man on his face in worship. Job is swimming in a pool of adversity, but he responds with adoration. Job is neck deep in woes, but he responds with worship. And imagine the scene. The demons are all standing there with their jaws wide open on the ground. This is not what you told us, Satan. And Satan looks at it. And at the end of the story, the only one left cursing is the devil himself. And as if it couldn't get any worse for Satan, what does he hear from old Job? You give and take away. You give and take away. But my heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Naked I came into this world. Naked I will leave. But the Lord has provided. So blessed be the name of the Lord. Hear me, affluent American church folk. We come into this world with zero. We leave with zero. And everything in between that we spend so much time on that wall being deceived by our money is not given to us by anyone other than the Lord God Almighty. Everything that you, when you leave this place and you walk out with your clothes, you're going to take those clothes off and go to a closet where you have choices of clothes you're going to wear. That's all given to you on loan by God. When you get in your temperature-controlled cars and you go and pull food out of your pantry, all on loan from God. Every single thing in between the time you come with zero and leave with zero, God says, here, you manage this. I thought about this, and as I was thinking about it, I was like, everything in my life that matters most, I don't get paid to do. Dad, husband, friend, and it's the same for everybody else in the room. So if that's true, why in the name of deceptive teaching do we spend our whole lives on this stupid wall? But that's 2/3 and 97% of the other third. What are we doing? Bill said, it would be a magic trick. And he was joking. But it's really the plan. It's just whether or not you follow it. Tonight, we're going to stop. We got a break. So tonight, we're going to do something we're going to do infrequently throughout the year. It's called a conversation, a Sunday conversation. Tonight at 6 o'clock, we're going to meet for about an hour. Me and Bill are going to direct it. It's laid back. We're not beating anybody over the head with Bibles or anything like that. It's just called a Sunday conversation. And tonight's topic is God and money. 6 o'clock, right here. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to tell you about the mistakes that we've made with money. One of which I made a month ago. So it's not like way back. We're going to tell you about our struggles, our labors. And we're going to tell you what God says. And then we're just going to pray. And somewhere in the midst of that moment and this moment, somebody somewhere is going to break loose of the chains of this wall and get over on this one. And if the statistics go right, that'll be about 0.001% of you. Because every year we preach this, and every year the stats don't change. So who's grabbing the 0.001 today? We close with a song. We invite you back to this place tonight, 6 o'clock, just for a laid-back, funny, real, inspiring conversation that'll last no more than an hour or so. Duke's already been beat. There's no Super Bowl. What do you got to lose? See you tonight. Who's grabbing the 0.1%? Let's stand together. Lord, let the words of this song just be the cry of our hearts today. No more games.
I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be His than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses on land. Yes, I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Is that true? Is that true today? Is that true for you? Is it really? You give, you take away. Lord, blessed be your name.
I'd rather have Jesus than worldly applause. I'd rather be faithful to His dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to His holy name than to be
tough one right here. Only you can break through, because we're all in it, Lord. Let this be the cry of our hearts right here. Nothing but you, only you, Jesus. Search our hearts.
Just give me Jesus. Nothing that's good in this world lasts forever. Nothing that's good in this world lasts forever.
Church, you are commissioned today to grab on, to be the difference, to be the 0.01 today. Man, I hope to see you back here at 6 o'clock. Questions, answers, just a conversation. God bless you. Go today and be life in dead places. And thank you for your faithfulness. For our God is good. Amen and amen.